Welcome back to this fourth ACE tutorial, in which I'll start to look at some more advanced patches. I'm going to start from the initialized preset as usual, but this time the first thing I'll do is wire LFO1 directly to the audio input for VCA1. Set the pitch mode to semitones, so the LFO tracks the keyboard and becomes an audio rate oscillator. And make sure the knob is set to zero. And we now have a simple sine wave instead of the default sawtooth. I'll now set LFO2 to produce another sine wave. Wire it to the pitch modulation input for LFO1. And turn up the depth. And as you would expect, the sine wave from LFO1 begins to sweep up and down like a siren. With LFO2 running faster, and with less extreme modulation, we start to get a vibrato effect. But what if LFO2 was running faster still, up at audio rates? Let's zero the pitch knob and set it to semitones mode, so it's now at the same frequency as LFO1. And see what happens when I turn up the modulation depth. Now, as well as changing in pitch, the sine wave shape is distorted into a much more complex shape with sharper edges and prominent harmonics. Okay, now I'll disconnect the modulation and patch it to the phase modulation input instead. We now have very similar changes in tone, with the wave sounding brighter the more extreme the modulation. But this time the pitch of the wave doesn't change at all. So, if I vary the amplitude of LFO2 by modulating it with envelope 2, the resulting tone will change over time while remaining at the same pitch. This technique was the basis of the FM synths that became popular in the 1980s, and which should more accurately have been called PM synths, as this is phase modulation rather than frequency modulation. And it becomes more interesting with the two sine waves tuned to different frequencies. Let's set the pitch mode to partials rather than semitones, so that whole numbers correspond to exact harmonics, which tends to produce more regular harmonic waveforms. Tuning in between the partials, on the other hand, can result in more inharmonic, metallic sounding waves. With a suitable amplitude envelope, and in a higher register, we're starting to achieve a tinkly bell type of sound. More complex sounds can be created by using more than one modulating oscillator, or by using waves with more harmonics instead of just a simple sine. I'm going to do both. Let's first patch LFO2 via the multiplier underneath instead of directly to LFO1. And then I'll add oscillator 1 to the other side of the multiplier, and blend in just a small amount with the volume knob next to it. I'll now switch to partials mode again, tune oscillator 1 to the third partial, and set it to a square wave. Even just a tiny amount of this square wave makes a huge difference to the resulting sound. Another technique used in classic FM-style synthesis is feedback between the oscillators, or operators as they are usually called in this context. Let's wire LFO1's output to the multiplier so that it's also being modulated by itself. And the difference is huge. As well as becoming brighter and buzzier, the feedback loop has introduced an unpredictable, slightly chaotic quality. Remember, we're still only listening to the raw output of LFO1, so I can control the overall brightness and complexity of the sound by adjusting the phase modulation depth. However, we still have two filters available, which we haven't used yet. Let's reroute LFO1 through filter 1, and warm up the sound with a relatively gentle two-pole filter with some key tracking. Restore the initial attack by modulating from envelope 2. And let's make the feedback loop more complex and interesting by including the filter as well. In fact, I'm going to patch the filter output via the second multiplier and wire the mod wheel pin at the bottom to the modulation input. And I can now use the mod wheel to control the feedback amount and morph between our tinkly bell sound and something more reminiscent of a plucked string instrument or some kind of thumb piano. Okay, let's try another example. Again, using the same starting point. I've set LFO 1 to semitones with zero offset and wired it directly to VCA 1 so we have a simple sine wave patch. Then set LFO 2 to produce another sine wave and wired it to the phase modulation pin for LFO 1. If I leave the pitch knob for LFO 2 set at 1 and switch the mode to partial as before, the result is a sine wave an octave higher than LFO 1. And as before, the resulting wave sounds brighter and is more complex in shape. However, I'm actually going to pick subharmonics mode instead, which is similar to partial mode, but produces subharmonics below the root pitch rather than harmonics above it. So the default value of 1 now produces a sine wave an octave lower than LFO 1. Let's add a velocity-sensitive pluck articulation from envelope 2. And switch to monophonic mode. And we can now create deep, solid bass sounds, reminiscent of a bass guitar. Variations of this patch might tune LFO 1 up another octave for a 2-octave gap between the waves. Or up 7 semitones for a gap of an octave plus a fifth. Let's reduce the sustain level a touch for envelope 1 to add an initial pluck articulation to the volume envelope as well. And let's also set the sustain stage to fall gradually, so it decays like a plucked string rather than remaining at a constant level. I can also slow the attack of envelope 2 slightly to add a wah articulation, a little like a fretless bass. And I can enhance this impression further with careful use of the pitch wheel. However, what if I want a more aggressive sound with a harder attack? I'll set the envelope 2 attack back to its fastest setting and turn up the modulation depth, which helps a bit. But I can achieve a much more dramatically aggressive sound by switching LFO 2 to the tap map waveform. Let's temporarily wire LFO 2 to the VCA so we hear the sound directly. And switch to the tweak page. And notice what happens when I draw some different shapes into the mapping generator. The tap map waveform is generated using the values in this table, so we can freely draw in waveforms and create distinctly digital sounds. The more sharp edges we add, the more aggressive high harmonics will be present. And we can progressively randomize settings. Or soften them. Or reset all the values to zero if we want to start again. So let's switch back to the main page and patch LFO 1 back to the VCA. So we're not hearing our custom tap map waveform directly anymore, we're only using it to modulate the phase of LFO 1. The result still sounds very aggressive, however. So I'll reroute LFO 2 and patch it to LFO 1 via one of the filters. I can now soften the sharp edges of our aggressive, buzzy-sounding custom waveform to create a warmer, basic tone. Then modulate the filter from envelope 2 to add those aggressive harmonics back in at the start of each note. Okay, let's look at another use for the tap map waveform. This time I'll patch it to the pitch modulation input for oscillator 1 and set the depth to 12 semitones. Then switch to the tweak page again and set the number of steps for the mapping generator to 16. We now have a simple step sequencer, which we can use to create melodic patterns. and we can quantize the step values to force them to an equal tempered scale. Let's go back to the main synth page, turn down the filter cutoff, add some resonance and key tracking, and modulate it with the same step sequence from LFO2. But actually, there's another way to set up the mapping generator for step sequencing duties. Let's modulate the filter cutoff from the mapper output at the bottom instead of from LFO2. Then set up the ramp generator with the up parameter at maximum, and all the others turned right down. Now I'll switch back to the tweak page. Set the mode for the tapping generator to quantize, and the source to ramp. Then switch the ramp generator to 4-4 host sync. And we now have our step sequence again, but this time driven from the ramp generator instead of LFO2. Let's switch back to the main synth page again, turn down the ramp attack, and turn up decay instead. So our filter sequence is now running backwards, while the oscillator pitch sequence is still running forwards. And I'll also turn off sync for LFO2. So the pitch sequence runs freely in sync with the host, and unlike the filter sequence, doesn't restart for each note I play. The relationship between the two sequences now depends on the timing of each note I play. I can also create random filter modulation. Let's modulate the filter from LFO1 as well. Then wire the white noise output at the bottom to the sample and hold input for the LFO, labeled S and H. With this input connected, every zero crossing from the LFO samples the current value at the S and H pin, and holds it until the next zero crossing. With random white noise connected, the result is a stream of random values clocked at the same rate as the LFO. Let's set a sync value of 4, and I'll also turn down the phase knob for the LFO. In sample and hold mode, this knob provides gentle smoothing of the transitions, so I need it all the way down to create sudden jumps between random values. I'm going to do something more interesting, however. Let's disconnect our random values, and instead I'll modulate the filter directly from oscillator 1. We've seen already that modulating parameters at audio rates can create complex and interesting new waveforms. Audio rate filter modulation provides a similarly wide range of interesting possibilities. In this case, we're modulating the filter with the same signal that it's processing. And the resulting sound depends upon complex interactions between modulation depth, cutoff and resonance settings, and even the input gain for the filter. So, let's reroute the audio rate filter modulation via a multiplier. Patch our random sample and hold signal to the mod input to randomly vary the amplitude. And let's finish off this sound with some glide. And a touch of delay from the effects section. That's all. Thanks for watching.